Happy Father's Day. There's some good-looking fathers in here this morning. Mr. Jimmy, good to see you too. And it is a joy to have all of y'all here today. We're going to miss those who are at the beach this morning, and we'll be glad to have them back. I think Michelle over there, we're missing her spot today. We're going to be thinking about her while she's away. Oh, my goodness. We've been working hard for Vacation Bible School. It's coming up this week. We are excited. We'll be talking about that in just a few minutes. But I'm going to ask you guys, if you can, to stand with us this morning. It's going to be a great morning to sing the joys of our Heavenly Father and how wonderful He is to us.
Praise is rising, eyes are turning to You. We turn to You. Hope is stirring, hearts are yearning for You. We long for You. When we see You, we find strength to face the day. In Your presence, all our fears are washed away. Washed away, Hosanna, Hosanna. You are the God who saves us, worthy of all our praises.
Among us, we welcome You here, Lord Jesus. Okay, dads, let's go ahead and get started, guys. Now, some of you have already let me know how uncomfortable you were in last week's meeting. So tonight, we're going to try to respect each other's boundaries.
What?
Tonight, we've also got a guest with us, David. And would you like to introduce yourself?
Yeah. Hey, guys. I'm David.
David.
How many kids do you have, David?
None. At least not at the moment. My wife is pregnant, and she should be delivering any day now.
That's great.
Super.
Oh, great.
Awesome. Who'd like to go first? Anyone. Anyone.
I'll go.
Perfect. Todd? Yes.
My daughter and I went to the mall, and she said she wanted to take the stairs to the second level. And I said, I don't trust stairs because they're always up to something.
Todd, I'm sorry that happened. I encourage you to try to resist the urge to make jokes like that.
My turn? Okay. Can I go? Okay. Yesterday, actually, my daughter got home and she asked me how my day was. And I said, well, a guy tried to sell me a coffin, but that's the last thing I need.
Oh, Jerry, that joke was dead on arrival.
Because it's the last thing I need.
David, how about you?
Oh, I didn't say
this is a safe zone. Just jump on in.
Yeah, I guess I'm just scared of being a dad. I'm afraid I'm gonna start telling bad jokes just like my dad.
Well, it might be in our nature. We can fight against it.
Hey, speaking of nature, I tried to catch some fog yesterday. I missed. M-I-S-T.
Oh, yeah. You're a monster. This is where the boundary is.
I'm done.
This is where you are.
Hello? Really? Okay, yeah, no. Yeah, I'll be right there. That was Julie. Her water just broke. I guess the baby finally ran out of womb. I'm gonna be a dad.
Don't you think you should be going?
Oh, yeah.
So I told my wife she drew her eyebrows too high. She seemed surprised.
I'm the number one dad joke teller, at least according to the shirt my daughter got me, so. We do love our dads. We do love our terrible, terrible jokes. And we're so thankful for our families for the fake laughs and the grins and not rolling their eyes while they're looking directly at us when we tell them. But it is a joy to have all of our fathers here today on Father's Day, all the families that came out to join with them. And a special happy Father's Day to you guys. We've got a special gift for you on your way out this morning. We've got some lovely young ladies that are going to meet y'all at the door and have something special for y'all. So y'all make sure you grab that on your way out. Just a few announcements, and I say a few. We've got a lot, and I like that. So this week, Vacation Bible School starts for real. And I'm looking forward to taking a nap afterwards. But we've been working hard, and we've got a lot of work done, and we're excited about Vacation Bible School. And remember to be praying for the families of our VBS this week. You know, we've got families need to be encouraged, and so be praying for the families of our kids this week, and encourage them to pray that they'll come and be a part. We've got in our closing ceremonies every night at 7:30. We've got a place for our families to come in and hear what the kids are doing, and especially for Thursday night when there's a gospel presentation. You know, we're looking forward to that night. So definitely be in prayer for us this week for Vacation Bible School. A few other things going on. Next Sunday, we have an ice cream social and business meeting next Sunday at 6 o'clock. So if you want some wonderful ice cream and a little bit of business, that'll be next Sunday night at 6 p.m. I think Brother Tab made a motion last business meeting that we had to have ice cream on our next business meeting. So we're going to honor that. And that's right. So we'll have but we need y'all to bring the ice cream. So y'all bring the ice cream. We'll do a little business and we'll have a good time next Sunday night at 6 o'clock. Following Sunday is July the 3rd. We're going to do a community cookout and celebration. We want to invite our community in. We're going to do some hamburgers that night. We're going to fry up a little fish. We're going to have a good time that evening. We just want to have a wonderful time of celebration with our community. So invite some folks out, and we're looking forward to that. We've got an adult Bible study that's going to be kicking off at Cass and Jamie Sutton's house July 10th at 5 p.m. That's a adult Bible study. It's called It's Not Too Late by Tony Evans. So we're looking forward to starting that group. We've got the marriage retreat coming up November 11th and 12th. So you can get registered for that. That's going to be a $50 non-refundable deposit due at registration. We're registering now through July 17th. Also, in some community news, we've got the Athletics for All Special Needs Honor Game coming up June 28th at 6 o'clock or 6:30 that evening at the Lawrence County High School baseball field. There's going to be a silent auction that night. And what a great opportunity for us to go out and connect with our community and members of our church. So I encourage you guys to come out. And then we're also working towards, should be in your bulletin next week, we are planning for the final Sunday in July, a night of praise. And that's just a night just to come and sing. I absolutely love singing and praising our Savior. So we're going to try and design a special night just to come out, invite our families, invite our community, maybe get somebody who hasn't sung a special in a while to come and sing with us. And whether she knows it or not, we're going to be working real hard on getting her to come sing that night. But we're doing some efforting and some special things we're planning that night. So we're looking forward to that on Sunday, July 31st. So keep us in your prayers as we begin planning that evening. And it's going to be a good time. It's going to be a good time. So I want to share with you guys, over the last few weeks, I've been reading from Psalms just to kind of help prepare our hearts a little bit for a time of worship. And the Psalms is just a beautiful place to go. And this morning, we're getting ready to sing a song called God of Wonders, because our Heavenly Father is a God of wonders. He has created the universe. He's created everything in it. But the psalmist, in Psalms chapter 8, he writes this: Yahweh our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. You have covered the heavens with your majesty. Because of your adversaries, you have established a stronghold from the mouths of children and nursing infants to silence the enemy and the avenger. When I observe your heavens, the work of your fingers, the moon and the stars which you set in place, what is man that you remember him, the son of man that you look after him? You made him little less than God and crowned him with glory and honor. You made him Lord over the works of your hands. You put everything under his feet, all the sheep and oxen, as well as the animals in the wild, the birds of the sky and the fish of the sea that pass through the currents of the seas. Yahweh our Lord, how magnificent is your name throughout the earth. We can sing of his glories and we can sing of his wonders, but he is our Heavenly Father. And he remembers his children. And on a day like Father's Day, for some days, some Father's Day are real easy for some. For others, it's a real hard time. But we can remember that we have a Heavenly Father, that in the midst of all of this amazing, awesome creation, he remembers us. And how amazing that is. God, we come to you this morning. We're so thankful that you consider man. Of all the great and awesome creation, you love us. You care for us. You consider us. You sent your son to die for us. We are important to you. And God, we love you, that you are our Father in heaven. You will never let us down. You will never hurt us. You always know what is best for us. And God, we thank you for that. And in that spirit, may we worship you this morning, for it is in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen. So I invite you to stand if you can this morning as we sing God of Wonders.
Lord of all creation, of water, earth, and sky, heavens are your tabernacle. Glory to the Lord on high, God of wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. Lord of heaven and earth. Early in the morning, I will celebrate the light. Stumble in the darkness, I will call your name by night. God wonders beyond our galaxy. You are holy, holy. The universe declares your majesty. You are holy. To the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth.
It's so amazing, so awesome. God created the moon, the stars, the earth, galaxies spinning as far as we can see and even beyond. But yet he desires to hold us, to reveal his heart to us.
God of wonders beyond our galaxy, you are holy, holy. Precious Lord, reveal your heart to me. Father, holy. Hold me, the universe declares your majesty. You are holy, holy. You are holy, holy. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah. Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth. Hallelujah to the Lord of heaven and earth.
God, we're so thankful this morning. You are the Lord of heaven and earth, but you are a good, good Father. And we're so thankful for that this morning.
I've heard a thousand stories of what they think you're like, but I've heard the tender whisper of love in the dead of night, and you tell me that you're pleased and that I'm never alone. You're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am. who I am. And I've seen many searching for answers far and wide, but I know we're all searching for answers. Only you provide, 'cause you know just what we need. Before we say our word, you're a good, good Father. It's who you are. It's who you are. It's who you are. And I'm loved by you. It's who I am.
Beyond all treasure that he should give.
Heavenly Father, we know your love is so deep and so amazing. You loved us so much that you were willing to give your own son for us. God, we didn't deserve it. How you remember man just amazes us, but you are such a good father. God, I thank you that this morning on a Father's Day, we can worship God the Father. And so thankful for everything that you have done for us. And for it is in the name of your Son, Jesus. And as witnessed by your Holy Spirit this morning, we pray. Amen. You may be seated.
Amen. Good morning. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord. We've got a lot of folks that are back that have been out traveling. And we got a lot of folks that are out traveling. And I was sharing with some guys yesterday at the Brotherhood breakfast. It's almost like we work in a plant with shift workers. You know, we got first shift, second shift, third shift, and if we ever get everybody here all together, we're going to have a hard time parking them all. Before we get started, I have a card up here this morning I just want to share with you. And it just says, thanks so much. It says, the phrase is simple and the words are few, but behind them is a whole lot of appreciation. Thank you so much for the prayers, calls, and visits. Special thanks for the delicious food you sent Saturday. My grandkids loved the pizza. The wind chimes on the porch bring fond memories. Thanks again for all the thoughtfulness, and please continue to pray for us. And it's signed, the Billy Gadsden family. And I ask that you do continue to call them out in prayer. Well, this is Father's Day, and a lot of us guys here this morning maybe got the obligatory socks or the new house shoes or the T-shirt or a card, or maybe a call, or maybe a text, and you know, they're all precious, and we love those, and by all means, please don't stop, because some of us, that's the only time we get new socks is on Father's Day, but I like to always open us up on Father's Day in prayer. So I'm going to ask all you guys to come down here and join me at the altar this morning, young, old, father or not, grandfather, great-great-grandfather. I'm going to ask you to just come down here and join me, and you can bring your little ones if you like to. That'd just be awesome. And we'll just get anywhere down here you want. You can get on the seats. You can get on the steps. You can get up here in the choir loft with me. Just get somewhere and just root you out a good spot and get comfortable. And I just want to say, guys, before I pray, we're all facing something. We're supposed to be the strong tower in our home. We're supposed to be the guy with all the answers. Listen to me when I say this. It's okay if we don't have the answers. God has brought me to a place where I realize I can't fix this. I don't know what to say. I don't know which direction to take. And you know what? It's going to be okay. Because some of you have come along beside me to say, hey, listen, I've been there, I've done that. And I promise you, if you were to share with somebody sitting to your right or your left what's going on in your life, they may have already been through that. And those of us that have not been through it yet, we need to know how God got you through it. We're not made to be islands, guys. We're not made to have all the answers, but we are made to know the one who does. And that's Jesus Christ. And we'll ask you guys as we pray right now, let God have whatever it is that's holding us back. There is a remedy for whatever's going on in our life. We just have to be willing to hear what it is, guys. Fathers, we bow before you this morning, Lord. I want to thank you for the awesome privilege of being able to call you my Father. To be able to say, our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. God, thank you for giving us this avenue through your Son, Jesus Christ, Lord, through the conviction of the Holy Spirit, God, that we can call out to your name. God, that we can sing praises to your name. Father, thank you for that, Lord. God, thank you for in my life giving me a godly father that prayed for me, Lord, that I would surrender to the will that you have in my life. God, thank you for allowing me to be a father, Lord, for sending me a precious wife, Lord, and two godly daughters, Lord. And Father, it's not anything that I did. God, it's all You. Father, thank You for that in my life. Thank You for the men that are bowed here with me in this building this morning, Lord. Some of them are just giants in my mind, Lord. Some of them are so much younger than me, Lord, and have so much godliness in them, Lord. Some of them have so much wisdom that they've poured into my life. God, thank You for that. God, I pray that we're paying it forward, Lord, what You've done in our life. God, that we pay it to those around us that are hurting. God, those that are in need. Father, I pray for us guys this morning, Lord, that we reach out and we just grab You by the hand, Lord, and let You lead us. God, help us admit, I can't fix this. God, I don't know what to say. God, I don't know which way to turn. But Lord, I know if I follow You, if I listen to You, it's going to be okay. Thank You, Lord, for today and for what You're going to do in our lives today. Father, we just pray these things in the precious name of Jesus Christ. Amen. Thank you guys for joining me down here this morning. We're still looking at faithful fathers. We're going through that this month. And I want to talk this morning to you about the faith of a master builder. And if you've ever watched the Lego movie, you know what I'm talking about. There are those that dabble in Legos and they put a few little things together, and yeah, it kind of looks like this if you squint one eye and close the other eye. But then there's the master builder that does not need instructions. They can make anything. I mean, they can make this big, enormous, whatever and however. And guys, I want us to look at the one that does not need instructions today, and that is God, the master builder. And for us to be faithful fathers, that's the one that we must follow. And I'm going to ask you the same question that I've asked you several weeks already. How will we affect the future of those around us? How will we, personally, guys, ladies, every one of us, point the finger back at you and say, how will I affect the future of all those people around us? As a master builder, I want to talk to you today about a house, about a home. Not too long ago, we built a new home. Some of you have built a new home, or you've bought a home, or you've looked at a home, or you've had to go help somebody with a home. You're familiar with the issues that a home has. If the roof leaks, it may not be so bad today, but you give it a few years, it's going to be terrible. You've ever driven by a barn all your life, and it's all of a sudden starting to just blow away piece by piece, all because of one screw or one nail in the side. Something came loose and it started tearing the entire building down. That one little teeny weeny thing. Or there was a creek that just got out of bounds and started washing a little closer and a little closer and a little closer, and finally it got over to the corner of the structure, and before long that side started falling in. I want us today to think about our life as a house, as a structure. It could be just a pole barn, just a top. It could be a lean-to in the bushes. It could be an ornate mansion set up on a hill that lights up and everybody can see it no matter where they are, and we're a landmark. But I want us to think about our life as a house, as a builder. And I want to ask us, are we a master builder? We're going to look at two versions of the same intent today. We're going to start out in Matthew chapter 7, and then we're going to flip over to Luke chapter 6. So turn with me firstly to Matthew chapter 7 and verse 21 through 27. These passages both end up talking about where to build your house. But these two passages start with a different set of instructions. And the idea is that these instructions are given, and then the phrase is said, if you are a wise builder and listen to my words, this is how you will build your house. But if you're an unwise builder and don't listen to how I speak to you. This is how you'll build your house. So they both start out with different instructions, but they both compare to what a builder is, a wise builder or an unwise. Matthew chapter 7, starting in verse 21. I'm going to be reading this to you from a King James. I think Brother Brian's got it up there with us. He says, "Not everyone that says unto me," now this is in red, means Jesus says this, "Not everyone that saith unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that doth the will of my Father which is in heaven. Many will say to me that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in thy name, and in thy name have cast out devils, and in thy name done many wonderful works? Then will I profess unto them, I never knew you. Depart from me, ye that work iniquity. Therefore, whosoever heareth these sayings of mine and doth them, I will liken him unto a wise man which built his house upon a rock. And the rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew and beat that house, and it fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. And everyone that heareth these sayings of mine and doth them not shall be likened unto a foolish man which built his house upon the sand. Rain descended, and the floods came, and the winds blew, and beat upon that house, and it fell, and great was the fall of it." Now, I want you to put your ribbon in there. Maybe you've got your bulletin. You can use it to help mark your place. Go with me to Luke chapter 6. We're going to read the same warning, but a different set of rules that if we adhere to or if we don't adhere to. So Luke chapter 6, starting in verse 43. "For a good fruit doth bring not forth corrupt fruit, neither doth a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit. For every tree is known by its own fruit. For of thorns men do not gather figs, nor of bramble bush gather they grapes. A good man out of the good treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is good. And an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart bringeth forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart his mouth speaketh. And why call ye me Lord, Lord, and do not these things which I say? Whosoever come to me and hear my sayings and doth them, I will show you to whom he is like. He is like a man which built a house and dig deep and laid the foundations on a rock. And when the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently upon the house and could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. But he that heareth and doth not is like a man that without a foundation built a house upon the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately it fell, and the ruin of that house was great." So we have the same comparisons, but we have different warnings. Jesus is trying to say two different things to us, and he's saying if you're wise, then your house will be built upon a rock by doing what I tell you to do. But if you are unwise, your house will not be built upon a rock, and it will not stand. Now, according to Baptist tradition, we have 3 points to make this morning. The first one being, prepare the foundation. Now I want you to go back with me and imagine your life is a house. Now we all live in a home or some kind of dwelling, or we live with somebody, and that home, that house, that dwelling is decorated in a certain flair. Now granted, if I were by myself, my house would probably look like those that you see on hoarders. It would be so piled full of things because I got this from somebody, that from somebody, and the wall would just be solid with things hanging on it and bookshelves, and it would be about 7 feet in dust. But everybody's house is decorated a certain way, and your life is also decorated that certain way, right? So we have to look at our house and how our house is foundationed. Now, I've shared with you before that I got real smart about a week and a half ago and stepped on some nails on my right foot. So my physical foundation is bothering me. But my spiritual foundation does not. My feet may hurt, but my life does not. If you look at your foundation, you have to ask yourself, are you standing on a sand foundation or are you standing on a rock foundation? The passage says, for a sound foundation or a rock foundation, you have to dig deep. Now, how deep is deep enough to dig in sand? Now, my wife's biological father was a construction superintendent. He knew more about building stuff and forgot more about it than I'll ever know. But I remember him telling me about building things and having to dig down and put these things called pylons. He called them caissons, but that's not actually, I can't find that word in the dictionary, so I don't know. But in essence, what it is you start digging really, really deep, and the deeper you go, the wider you get, and you pour this bell-shaped entity, and you pour enough of those things. The theory is that you can get enough of them that it'll kind of stand on itself on the sand. So you're kind of making a wide base, and you're really just floating, not so much as standing. Now you got to ask yourself, how good is that sand foundation? It ain't. Let me remind you of something that happened last year, June the 24th of 2021 at 1:22 in the morning. Champlain Tower South, a 12-story beachfront condominium in the Miami suburb of Surfside, Florida, fell partially. 98 people were killed, 4 people were rescued from the rubble, 1 died of injuries shortly after, and 11 others were injured. 35 were rescued from the same day from the uncollapsed part of it, which was torn down 10 days later. Y'all remember that? The thing fell down. All of us are thinking, oh my goodness, I wonder if the condo I've got booked at the beach is going to do the same thing. That thing fell because of several different factors. We know that it was corroding, we know that it was collapsing, and we know that it was not maintained. Now, if you look at a rock foundation, again, he said, dig deep until you hit rock. Have you ever had to dig something, and as the Lord saw fit, and as Murphy's Law always rules, there's a rock right slap in the way. Now, you got to ask yourself, do I pound on this rock? Do I dig around this rock? I was laughing with my family the other day. They're running a gas line down the highway by my house, and they've come right to here, and everybody's like, oh, hallelujah, we're going to have natural gas through here. Those guys have got to be kin to me because they have just done this. There's no rhyme or reason. They're right up by the road. They're way over here. And I know it's because they're trying to avoid those rocks and those roots and those things. He said, dig deep and lay into the rock. Get down to that immovable object. Now, I know that there's some geologists in the house who'll argue with me that even a rock will eventually move, but just humor me here. Embed into the immovable objects, tie into something that is firm, sit on something that never sinks. Guys, have you ever had to hang a picture in the house? What's the first thing you do? You go over the wall and you start knocking till you find a stud, and that right there is where I'm going to hang the picture. That ain't where I want the picture. I want it over here, but honey, there ain't a stud over here. I got to get in the stud, in the heavy wall, because this thing weighs more than I do, and if I hang in the sheetrock, it's going to fall off at 2 o'clock in the morning. I'm going to jump up, think somebody's in the house, screaming like a little girl, and I don't want that. You see where I'm going with this? You want something that's solid to put your house on, right? You don't want to just kind of float. How good is a rock foundation? Well, it's permanent. Now, granted, there is nothing considered permanent, but in the scheme of things, being on a rock is the best construction base that you can have. It's hard, it's firm, it never moves. It'll be the same tomorrow as it is today. Now in Luke, where we started out, in chapter 6, verse 43, it says, a good fruit brings forth not corrupt fruit, a good tree, neither doth a corrupt tree bring forth good fruit, for every tree is known by its own fruit. For if thorns men don't gather figs, nor if bramble bush gather they grapes, a good man out of the good treasure of his heart brings forth that which is good, and an evil man out of the evil treasure of his heart brings forth that which is evil. For of the abundance of the heart, his mouth speaks. So what kind of fruit are we bearing? We have to ask that question. Fruit being the actions of our heart, which drives the actions of our life. Where is our heart planted? Is it in the sand where it's always moving like the evil fruit, or on the rock where it never moves? Verse 44 says, every tree is known by its own fruit. I can't claim the fruit of my father. My father was a godly man, but that did absolutely nothing for the fruit in my life. Yes, he dropped that fruit on me, but I had to take my own root. You ever seen bird seed hedge? Some folks call it privet, I guess. Grows in a fence row. It's real pretty when it starts up, and then there's 15, 27 million of them before long. You can't even see the fence. It starts dropping that fruit, and it starts growing. It's great if you don't want to keep your fence up, but it is the biggest nuisance there ever was. Now, conversely, we have that growing on one side of our fence where our daughter lives down in Auburn. She has these beautiful oak trees in her yard, and they're dropping those acorns all over everything, and they just grow all over the flower beds and all over the yard, and they're beautiful, but they're in the wrong spot. But everybody wants an oak tree in their yard because it gives good shade. Nobody wants that privet because all it does is just spread mess and gum. Are we dropping the good kind of fruit that's spreading like that, or the bad kind of fruit? Number two, we have to prepare for hard times. We've got a house. We've got to stand and look and say, what are we standing on? What is our house? Jesus said, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If anybody will open, I will come in and will sup with him, meaning that spiritual life, our house. We have a foundation, and we have to prepare for hard times. Some of us are old enough to remember Y2K. That's when the computers was going to crash, no money was going to work, nothing was going to happen, and we had to stock up and store up. And I remember my Aunt Ruth had enough canned goods for like 15 or 20 years. I mean, it was unbelievable how some folks prepared for that, but we don't prepare for today. We don't even prepare for tomorrow. If you look at a sand foundation, he said when the floods come, when the storms come, when the floods come, that would be those things that overwhelm you. Have you ever been overwhelmed before? If you've ever been at the beach and you're sitting down in the surf and everything's great and wonderful and a wave comes up and just splashes right over you, you know what it's like to be overwhelmed. Or when the storms come, that's those things that don't happen according to our plan. We've been talking about the rain. Man, it seems like everybody over yonder is getting rain and everybody over yonder is getting rain, but ain't nobody right here getting rain. And sometimes when we plan on it, we'll go out and lay the hay down, and man, I got 3 days. I can rake and roll that good stuff, and it rains on it overnight. Or you just washed your car, and it's great and clean. You're at work, and it rains, and you got to drive home. And that, those storms that come that aren't according to our plan, how does that foundation react when it's built upon the sand? Well, in Matthew chapter 7, verse 27 says, the rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew, and beat upon that house, the house in the sand, and it fell, and great was the fall of it. Luke 6:49 says, but he that heareth and doeth not is like a man that with a foundation built a house on the earth, against which the stream did beat vehemently, and immediately fell, and the ruin of that house was great. A foundation laid in sand cannot withstand the storms of life, but a rock foundation, when the floods come, those things that try to overwhelm you, when the storms come, those things that don't go according to our plan, the foundation holds. Matthew 7:25 says, the rain descended, the floods came, the winds blew and beat on the house. It fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. Luke 6:48 says, he is like a man which built a house and dig deep and laid the foundation on a rock. When the flood arose, the stream beat vehemently on that house and could not shake it, for it was founded on a rock. Now, does this make a rock foundation immune to storms? Absolutely not. Storms are going to come upon either foundation, but only the one that is embedded in the rock can withstand the storms. Like I said, guys, we are not the only one that's being beat upon. We may be standing on the rock. We may be firmly planted, but we're sick and tired of being sick and tired because the storms are coming and the waves are overrunning us, and we never know when there's a brother right here or a brother right there that's gone through it, going through it, that can take us by the hand and walk us through it. We are not made to be by ourselves, and we've got to admit that to ourselves before we can ever reach out for help. And I am speaking from experience on that. We've got to prepare the foundation, prepare for hard times, and lastly, number three, prepare for a legacy. We've got to prepare for a legacy. How are you known? How are you known today? Are you known by your name? Are you known by where you live? Are you known by your associations? Are you known by your family? By your job title? By how you look? How are you known? You see, for a sand salvation, a sand foundation, excuse me, we got to look at our salvation. See, in Matthew chapter 7 and verse 21, I got to get over to Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, my glasses on. Not everyone that says unto me, Lord, Lord, shall enter into the kingdom of heaven, but he that does the will of my Father which is in heaven. So if you look at standing on sand, we look at our salvation, will our legacy, will our house, will it be destroyed? Do we say, Lord, Lord, I've done these things in your name, I've all this in your name, but will our foundation crumble slowly or will our foundation crumble quickly? I think that, you know, a quick crumble is a whole lot better than a slow crumble. Because it shows a fallacy in our theology that building on sand is best. You know, sometimes when things happen quickly, it's an attention getter. But when it's slowly happening, you don't notice it. Slowly is a numbing situation, crumbling over time, sometimes so slowly that we don't even notice it. Go back to the analogy of the house. You see a crack in a wall. You got a door that won't shut or won't stay shut. You put your pen on the table and it rolls off over there. The canned good rolls off the counter. You just learn to live with those things and you never realize that you're standing on the sand and you're saying, Lord, Lord, but you don't live, Lord, Lord. I've cried out to you and I've cried out to you, Lord, and I've done all these things, but the problem is the Lord doesn't know me. Will your sand foundation stand the test of time? Absolutely not. You got a claim of knowing Jesus, but Jesus never knew you. You walked the walk and you talked the talk, but you never made the decision to give your life to Jesus Christ. You had everybody fooled, including yourself. But God will not be mocked. I've told this story before about a man. Misty had a brother-in-law one time. He put this guy in jail, and it was freezing cold. And he kept telling the guy, I'll go turn the heat up. And there was no heat. Before long, the guy was sweating. He was so hot. He convinced himself he was hot. They say right before you die of hypothermia, your mind tries to tell you you're hot, and you strip your clothes off, and it makes it even worse, and you freeze to death. Wouldn't it be sad? Wouldn't it be sad to live your whole life and you say, you know, I was born in this church. You know, I went to Bible school in this church. You know, I was in that baptistry in this church. You know, I died in this church. I knew who the Lord was. I taught Sunday school. I did all these things. And Jesus say, but I don't know you. Your sand foundation is going to hear, depart from me. Get away. Get away from me. You drive up to somebody's yard and they got a dog and that dog comes out baring teeth and snipping at you. The reason is that dog don't know you and it wants you to leave. You don't want that from Jesus. And it's not just your foundation. Okay, you got to hear me when I say this. My home, most of the time, there's three of us. This week, there's four of us. Four of us live inside our home together. together. And if the roof starts leaking, we're all going to get wet. If the roof falls in, we're all going to get squished. You see, my house, my foundation, is their foundation too. Who all is in your foundation? But you see, my daddy did it, so I can too. You see, my papa did it. It was good enough for papa, so it's good enough for me too. My brother does that, so it's good enough for me too. In Matthew 7:27, when the house fell, great was the fall of it. You know what great means? Horrific. In Luke 6:49, he says the ruin of that house was great. Ruin. Not only would I ruin me, them, y'all. Did you catch the difference in the foundations? Luke 49, he says, a man without a foundation built a house upon the earth. Matthew said sand, but Luke said the earth. Guys, are we building our foundation on this stuff here? Man, you can have every trinket, dink it, rink it, flink it, name it. Man, I got the awesome. I wanted to run out of the garage this morning, throw the door open, see that red Ferrari sitting there, but I knew it wasn't going to be there. I mean, it'd be great to have one, but you know what? Ferrari ain't going to get me to heaven. My relationship with Jesus Christ is. But if I spend all my time for things here, what does that say about my salvation, my foundation? Am I on sand? But the good news is there's a rock foundation. There's a rock salvation. We have to ask ourselves again, will our legacy be destroyed? You see, Jesus said, there are those that cry out to me, Lord, Lord. You can cry with your mouth, or you can cry with your actions. You can cry with a life that says, yes, you are my Lord. Will your foundation ever crumble? No. If you're on the rock, if you're living, Lord, Lord, your foundation will never crumble. It'll never fall. It'll never ruin. Now, is it possible to have a crack and not be perfect? Yes. Is it possible it'll need a little bit of routine maintenance? Yes. Will your foundation stand the test of time? Absolutely. Matthew said it this way in 7:25. Says the house fell not, for it was founded upon a rock. It didn't say it didn't fall in 20 years. It didn't say it stood 100 years. It said it fell not never. Luke said it this way in 6:48. Said all the floods and the streams could not shake it, for it was founded upon a rock. Now, what are the odds of those who live under your shadow having a rock foundation also? A lot better than those who are standing with you on a sand foundation. Psalm 92:13 says, those that be planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Where are we planted? Are we on the ground, the earth, the sand? Or are we on the rock? Yesterday at our brotherhood breakfast, we had down the Life Center, Brother Cass spoke. They've gone to be with his family. Brother Cass spoke, and he told about a guy he worked with. And that guy said, you know, I don't want to have kids. I don't want to bring kids into this world. It's just horrible. It's just terrible. And most of you know that Jamie and Cass are blessed to have their children because of the trouble they went through. And he said, you know, He said, I finally come to realize that maybe God needed my kids more than I did. You ever thought about that? You see, the Bible says that children are like arrows in the hand of a warrior. You see, the good thing about an arrow is you can shoot somebody way over yonder, where with a knife, they're going to have to get however far in to you. But you can take that arrow, and you can flick that thing way over. You're standing here. You can put one over there, and you can put one over there, and get one back there. And, I mean, you know, you can stand out in the yard and play the chicken game if you want to, but that's not what they're designed for. See, with children, you can aim those kids, and you can send one to this country, and you can send one to that county, and you can send one to that state, and you can send one on this job, and you can send one over to that place while you're still right here standing on the rock. You see, if you're on a good foundation, are you using those blessings that God gave you for God's glory? If you're on the sand, you'll never understand. Because you're getting beat over by the storms, you're getting run over by the waves, you're getting pushed aside. The Bible says the ruin will be great when Jesus says, depart from me. But if you're on the rock, and God gave me these kids, gave us these kids, gave us these friends, these family, these people, and we can say, hey, listen, I see you sinking in the sand. Why don't you come over here and stand on the rock with me? Are you on the rock? Sinking in the sand. I'm going to ask you to bow with me this morning. In just a minute, guys, in just a minute, this is going to be all over with. Ladies, in just a minute, this is all going to be over with. You can run out them doors, man, freedom. But right now, are you on the sand or are you on a rock? Right now, will you be destroyed and the fall be great, the ruin be great? Not just for you, but all those that look to you? Or are you on the rock that nothing can knock over? Not just you, but all those that look to you. Because you're telling them, I'm standing on the rock of ages. Father, it's my prayer this morning. Somebody here realizes they're standing on the sand and they need to get off. They need to get on the rock. They need to give their life to you. They need to become a child of the King. They need to say, I realize I'm lost. I realize I'm undone. I realize that I need forgiveness of my sins. And I ask Jesus Christ to forgive me of my sins, to come into my life and be Lord and Savior of my life, and then thank Jesus for saving me. God, who is that here this morning? God, it may be somebody here that's standing on the rock and they realize that they've never invited anybody else to join them. God, it's great for me and mine. I've got my fire insurance policy and I ain't worried about nobody else. Lord, convict us of that attitude. God, it may be there's somebody here this morning that's tired of struggling with the winds and the waves crashing against them, and they need a brother or they need a sister, they need somebody to walk with them. God, give them the courage to see this morning, Lord, that they can't fix this. That they're never going to know which direction to take, Lord. They must lean and trust in you. God, I stand publicly this morning to say thank you. Thank you for that in my life. Thank you for giving me that direction, God. Thank you for giving me those brothers, Lord. Thank you for giving me that walk, Lord. All I have to do is follow you. In just a minute, folks, we're going to be done. Right now, I want to know, are you on the sand or are you on the rock? Just a minute, we're going to stand up. Just a minute. And that's going to be your opportunity to come down to this altar. Pray for counseling, for whatever it is that you need. This is the place. It's a public profession. It's walking down here. It's putting some shoe leather to it, saying, hey, I got a problem. I'm tired of the winds. I'm tired of the waves. I'm tired of the sand. I'm worried about somebody. I need to know how to get them on the rock with you. We're going to do business with God. I ask you to stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed. You stay in an attitude of prayer while the music plays. You move. You move how God tells you to move. You trust God for whatever God is telling you to do. You pray. My own rock.